Suaveté omnes. Today I'm going through Romulus the King, pars secunda. So this is following Romulus the King, pars prima. And we're just continuing the story after the abduction of the Sabine women. All right, so the following days after the abduction of the Sabine women, and oh, by the way, before we get here, here's a silver coin from the 89 BCE by a man who was in charge of the mint, Lucius Titurius Sabinus. And the front page has a picture of Titus Tatius, who's the king of the Sabines, who we're going to talk about in a few in a little bit. And on the back, it has the abduction of the Sabine women on the back. You can see that it has Sabini here, Sabine here, and then T-A, like for Titus Tatius. And then it has his name here on the back, Titurius. So Lucius Titurius. So yeah, so there we go. So he traced his family back to the Sabines. So the women in the course of time lost the resentment. Remember, this is being told by Livy, okay, from a man's perspective. So take it with a cum grano salis, please. All right. However, their parents were still angry and wanted their daughters back. The citizens of Kynaea, Crustunium, and Antimina all went to the Sabine king, Titus Tatius, to ask him for help. But Tatius was slow in deliberations, and the other tribes could not wait. The people of Kynaea would not wait for the people of Crustunium and the people of Antinum, and they rushed to attack the Romans. So they all just went as fast as they could, and they didn't do it all together. The scattered groups were doing little damage to the Romans. Then Romulus with his troops came to the battle scene. According to Livy, a few blows were enough, and soon the people of Kynaea were taught that angry men must also be strong to achieve their purpose. All right. Now, Romulus pursued the routed men, and in his pursuit, he cut down the enemy king, Acron, or sometimes they call him Acro, and stripped him of his arms. Romulus then consecrated the first temple in Rome to Jupiter Ferentarius and placed the arms in the temple. Romulus called the arms spoili opima, which are like the fatty spoils or the fertile spoils. The spoili opima is later became the ultimate trophy to get. It is the king's armor taken by a king in battle. Spoili opima has only occurred on two more occasions in Roman history. So people always aim to do this. So if you were a king or a consul of Rome, and if you fought another king in combat from another state and you defeated them, then you could gain this. And there was a guy named Marcellus who, right before the Second Punic War in the third century BCE, actually did this. And here's a picture of him putting the armor and helmet and stuff in the temple of Jupiter on the Capitoline Hill, the special temple that Romulus created. So it was a big deal. So spoili opima. And here's a picture of Romulus holding the spoili opima from a painting from the 19th century. It's pretty cool, like the horse in the back. All right, next the people of Antemi took the opportunity and made a raid against the Romans. The people of Antemi were defeated with a single charge by the Romans. Romulus's wife, Hercilia, asked Romulus to pardon the parents of the daughters and let them live in Rome. Romulus granted the request. So this is the thing that's going to become very common with Rome, that they defeat people and they bring them into their country. Now we have Crustumium. The people of Crustumium were on the march against the Romans, but they were defeated. But the defeat of the neighbors had destroyed their confidence, and they were easily defeated. Roman settlers were sent out to Antemenae and Crustumium, and the fertility of the soil attracted a great number of volunteers. So the Romans sent out people to colonize these towns that fought against them. Also, parents of the captured women moved from Crustunium to Rome. So there was an exchange of populations. Now the Sabines. The Sabines launched a much more difficult and dangerous attack for the city. The Sabines waited and devised a careful plan to attack the Romans. Some Sabine soldiers approached a girl named Tarpeia, the daughter of the citadel commander named Spurius Tarpeius, while she was outside the walls fetching water for a sacrifice. So she had come out from the walls of the city, and she was getting water at the Tiber, and some Sabine soldiers ambushed her and captured her. Or who knows what happened, but they approached her. They offered her what was on their shield arms, because in those days the Sabines were known to carry heavy gold bracelets and fine jeweled rings on their left arms, which also carried their shields. And so they offered her a bribe. But when she led them into the citadel, they beat her to death with their shields, showing that you must never trust a traitor. And this is, of course, from Livy, who said that comment. And here's some pictures from the coins. This is made by the same guy as the previous coin. And you can see up top, there's two soldiers over a woman with shields. And then at the bottom there, on the right hand side, you can see there's a woman buried in coins, in shields. Now, the Romans were fiercely determined to recover the citadel and attacked. The first blows were struck between Metus Curtius, a Sabine, and Hostius Hostilius, a Roman. So there was two champions either side that started fighting between the two peoples. But Hostilius fell, and when he fell, the Romans retreated in disorder. It was not looking good for the Romans. Romulus was swept up in retreat and shouted a prayer to Jupiter. He said, "Hear me, O Jupiter, at the bidding of your eagles, I laid the foundations of Rome here on the Palatine. Our fortresses in Sabine hands basely betrayed. Thence are they coming, sword in hand, across the valley against us. Father of the gods and men, suffer them not to set foot on the spot where we now stand. Banish fear from Roman hearts and stop their shameful retreat. I vow a temple here to you, O Jupiter, stayer of flight, that men may remember hereafter that Rome in her trouble was saved by your help." So he said this epic prayer, and it is answered. Romulus, feeling his prayer was answered, ordered his men to turn back and fight the Sabines. Metius Curius, the champion on the Sabines, said, boasted his comrades, "We have beaten our treacherous hosts, our feeble foes. They now know that catching girls is a different matter than fighting against men." Romulus was immediately on Curtius, and Curtius turned in retreat, but the noise of the approaching people scared his horse, and he was thrown into the swamp. It was only with great effort that he was able to escape. The battle renewed, with the Romans taking the advantage. At this time, the Sabine women bravely thrust their way between the two armies. So the Sabine women come out between the two fighting armies. They parted the angry commandments and said, "We are mothers now. Our children are your sons, your grandsons. Do not put on them the stain of patricide. If our marriage, if a relationship between you is hateful to you, turn your anger against us. We are the cause of your strife. On our account, our husbands and fathers lie wounded or dead, and we would rather die ourselves than live on either widowed or orphaned." Here's a picture by David from 1799 that shows the epic, the women coming in between and parting the people fighting. I like the woman in the back holding the child up, showing everyone. The war is over. The actions of the women had a great effect upon both sides. The two states were decided to be united under a single government with two kings, Tatius and Romulus. And here's a painting from the 17th century showing the reconciliation of Romulus and Titus Tatius. And there we go. And the war was over. What will happen next? All right. Volete, omnes lingua latina est vita.